All right, well, we'll go ahead and start. Happy Valentine's Day to everyone. Yes. Thank you. I hope that some of you have someone special to spend the evening with, but I appreciate that you're here now. And with Valentine's Day in mind, we're going to talk about today wedding traditions around the world. I've been in a few weddings myself in a few different countries, and I will focus on some of those with some videos and kind of in-depth descriptions. And then we'll also look at some unique wedding traditions in other countries around the world that you may never have heard of. Everything from everyone kissing the bride who's single to people spitting on the bride. In some countries, this is normal. So we'll talk about that later. I'd like to hear from you what typical Belarusian wedding traditions are, because I've never been in a Belarusian wedding before, but I believe some people in the room are married, yes, maybe, or were at some time. And at the end, we'll finish with a Kahoot quiz. A Kahoot quiz is an online interactive quiz. Questions will come up here, and if you have a smartphone, then you can go on there and you can answer the questions, and we'll get into that at the end. So, first, American wedding traditions. I myself am not married yet, but a couple of my friends have married, and in each of these countries, I will put down here the average age of first marriage. In the United States, for a man, it's 29 years old, so I'm 26, so I still got some time. And for a woman, it's 27. And before a wedding, typically you have a bridal shower. Does anyone know what a bridal shower is?
So if you get acquainted with the families of opposite partners, so brides or bridegroom.
Usually at the bridal shower, it's just the women though. It's basically a party for the bride and all of her girlfriends, and the women of both families will come together. And it's not like a shower, like a douche, but it's more like a shower, like, hello, come on in. Like, you shower her with gifts. She gets a lot of gifts. So her girlfriends come together and give her a bunch of gifts, usually baby gifts. And you also have a baby shower, which is the same kind of a thing. That may be the same as, or it may be a separate event as, a bachelorette party. Are you familiar with a bachelorette party? Basically the last time to celebrate that you're single. And the same thing happens for the men too. It's called a bachelor party. Some guys go to Vegas. I think there's a movie about that. What's it called?
Hangover.
Yes, that's right. Where they go for a bachelor party to Vegas. So that's kind of a stereotypical bachelor party. Usually this will happen a week or two or a few weeks before the wedding. And in America, you also have a gift registry. So a gift registry is to help prevent getting gifts that you don't want, or that you have multiple gifts of the same thing. And so what it is that a bride and a groom will register online or at a store, a big department store like Macy's or Nordstrom's, or on Amazon.com, where you can buy almost everything online, and they'll make a list and say, if you're looking to give us a gift, these are the things that we need for our new home. Yeah, everything from a tea kettle to a TV, or even pots and pans, or forks and knives. And this gift registry then will show, someone has already purchased this, or if you're looking for a gift in the price range of $5 to $25, you can look at these. If you're looking from $50 to $100, you can look at these. And it's very well organized, this gift giving for weddings in the United States. It used to be just at a department store, but now you see a lot of it on Amazon.com. And then, of course, the wedding planning. There's actually a movie called The Wedding Planner, I believe. And there's also careers in wedding planning, a wedding planner. Yeah. So people make a living off of just planning other people's weddings. That's a professional job in the United States. It can be a hectic job, too, I believe. But that is a whole career. I have a friend who is a wedding planner. So some important things about American weddings is always the cake. The cakes are very elaborate. We even have a TV show in America about cake, wedding cake like wedding cake decorators, people who make wedding cakes, and the exotic, crazy kind of cakes that people will order for their wedding day. It's a whole TV show. It's on every week. Yeah? And typically, no matter how crazy the cake is, there will always be the bride and groom on top of the cake. And they may be traditional, like here, like standing at the altar. They may be dancing, or there may be the groom like kissing the woman's shoes or feet or something funny. There's all different kinds. And that's typically on top of the cake. And I mean, it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. But sometimes there'll even be a cake like this, and then like cupcakes, and they'll just give out little cupcakes to the people, because that's much easier to share than cutting this masterpiece. And of course, there's usually the cake in the face, and the bride and groom cut it, and whoever's hand is on top of the knife, then there's the upper hand in the marriage, and these kind of funny traditions. Other important features of an American wedding include the first kiss. After they say, I do, the first kiss is a big thing for us. Then also when you have the banquet or the reception afterwards, toasts are very important. And there's almost always a toast by the best man, who is the best, or the guy who stands next to the groom, and the maid of honor, the woman who stands next to the bride. And usually the bride's father will also give a toast as well about how great this young man is that is marrying his daughter, and so forth. The first dance is also very special, and a special moment that's always featured in an American wedding, and the dance with the bride and her father. That's also very popular. And sometimes you'll see that in weddings they get very elaborate, very creative in these dances, and maybe the bride and groom will have planned a whole kind of funny dance for their wedding. And if you look on YouTube, you see a lot of these examples. There's also the car procession, which is where you'll see the car with written on it, just married, and it drives through the city with a couple. Usually that would happen in between the church to the party, the dinner, the reception. And they would have some kind of nice car with just married written on it, and maybe aluminum cans hanging from the bottom that ring on the road and make a lot of noise. So here is a look into a short little video of an American wedding. I actually flew back from Israel to go to this wedding a couple years ago. This was the first friend of mine from high school who got married. And this will give you a look into somewhat of more of a religious American wedding, what it would look like.
This passage from Matthew makes it so clear. And I know it's not talking about marriage, but the principle still applies. Build your house on the rock. I told you this already, and I will tell you again. When two people who love Jesus come together in marriage, I don't think there's anything they can't get through. 50% chance is out the window. They will have differences. There will be troubles, trials will come, but build your house on the rock of Jesus Christ, and when the storms come, they will not prevail. You both know, as God's Word teaches, your marriage is to be a reflection of Jesus, His love, His character, His glory to the world.
Always have a young girl who's the flower girl and a young boy who's the ring bearer.
Down onto her. This marriage must go beyond the boundaries of the two of you and overflow into the lives of others. Rachel are now going to take communion together for the first time as a married couple. Chris and Rachel, at this time, I now pronounce you husband and wife. What God has joined together, let man not separate. Chris, you may now kiss your bride.
You see it in this example. This is a fairly religious wedding, but it's still not taking place in a church. It's outside. And it's pretty typical today in America that you have your wedding in some kind of location other than a church, even if the couple is very religious. And this toss of the bouquet is also something that always happens, and this signifies that the woman who caught that, the girl who caught that, is the next woman to be married of all of the single ladies who are at that wedding. The first dance, like we talked about, and also, of course, there were toasts in there that were not featured in the video. So that's an example of an American wedding, actually right back in my hometown. And after the wedding in America, most people go on honeymoon, usually the week directly after, and the most popular honeymoon destination for Americans is Hawaii. My parents went to Hawaii as well. Hawaii is the place that almost all Americans go when they get married. People in Hawaii, when they get married, though, I do not know. Maybe they go to California or Florida, I don't know. But as a whole, Americans mostly go to Hawaii for their honeymoon, usually the week directly afterwards. So that would be an American wedding. I would say America has taken in a lot of different traditions from other places. It's not, we don't have the traditional history of weddings that other countries may have because we're a young country. We'll look at Germany now, and it will look in many ways completely different. So, in Germany, the average age of marriage is a little bit older. You're already in your 30s. The average age for a man, 33. For a woman, 31. And in Germany, you also have the bachelor party or the bachelorette party. This is called a Jungensgesellenabschiedfeier. And you also have a Polterabend. So the Polterabend is an event with the families where you destroy a bunch of cups and glasses. Has anyone ever experienced something like that? No? We got videos, don't worry. They're coming up. So maybe 2 weeks before the wedding, the groom and the bride would have their bachelor and bachelorette parties, and then the week before the wedding would be the Polterabend with the families, and the day of the wedding, you would have a civil ceremony at the city hall in the morning, which means you go to the local government and sign the papers, and you get married with the state, basically. Then you would often have a car procession where the same thing we talked about with the just married and driving a car and maybe a fancy rented car to the church. And you would have the ceremony at the church. And then you would move to where the party or the reception is afterwards. There's also sometimes in Germany a tradition of kidnapping the bride. This is not like in the olden days, where you kidnap a bride and to marry her, but rather it's kind of a joke and a game today. She may be kidnapped and hidden in the local pub or the bar or something, and the groom has to go there and find her and buy a round of drinks for everyone in the bar. One thing that I've realized that's different with American or with German weddings and other weddings that I've experienced is there's a lot of money involved in the traditions. So in the for the bachelorette party or the bachelor party, let's say for the bachelorette party, the bride-to-be may be dressed up really funny with all of her girlfriends, and they will parade through downtown of the small city or the big city and have a bunch of schnapps or little shot glasses of different drinks, maybe Jägermeister, and goes around selling these for €2 a piece to collect money for their wedding. And this is a typical thing people do before they get married. At the bride napping, sometimes you also have to pay a bribe, pay money for the bribe. At the church, when you leave the church, there's usually little kids from the church standing there, and you're supposed to give a coin or a euro when you leave. And in the reception, there's usually a Hochzeitzeitung, meaning a wedding newspaper that will have pictures of the couple and their history together, made into a newspaper or a journal, and that will be sold to guests at the reception. So it's all, I get that it's for the bride and the groom to, you know, to help pay for their wedding, because weddings are freaking expensive. So, Polterabend. So this is a German tradition that is to wish the couple good luck in their marriage together. And it has to do with taking all of the old porcelain and chinaware that you have that you do not use anymore. And with the whole family, you basically destroy these right in the driveway. And you'll see that this is a Bavarian wedding. And so everyone is dressed up in this traditional Bavarian lederhosen and drindel, which is exactly the same attire that I wore when we did the German presentation last semester, as you may remember. So this is the Polterabend in Bavaria the week before the wedding. Everyone does it. Grandma, grandpa, everyone gets into the bashing of the plates. Boom. And basically it goes on like that for the whole afternoon. And then the bride and groom have to clean up all of the mess. And then you'll have a big meal for all of the family that were there that day. These are my friends who got married, actually, right there. So it goes on for hours. Boom. Thousands of pieces are destroyed in this Polterabend. And so that's the week before. It's kind of like a get ready for the wedding event. And then when you have the actual wedding, like I said before, you will have a meeting first in the city hall, which you'll see here. And then you'll move to the actual church. And so this is in the city hall, and this is just with the bride and groom and the very, very closest of the families. And this is when they're officially married, just so to say. And they are not as religious as the American couple that we saw in the first film, but they have their wedding in Germany in a church, as it's kind of standard tradition in Germany. Even people who are not very religious will have their wedding in the church. It rained this day. That was unfortunate. But you see, very formal. You can, to the wedding here, you can wear a suit, or you could wear that same Bavarian outfit that you saw in the last video, and that would be considered formal. The lederhosen and drindel are actually very formal for Bavaria. Some people did wear them here, and they are just as expensive as a suit. Or a really nice gown. It costs hundreds of euros for that traditional Bavarian wear. You might recognize that guy right there. Mm-hmm. You'll have the ceremony in the church, and then everyone will leave the church together and move to the reception area. And at the reception, there's those little kids I told you about who collect money on the way out the door. And at the reception, a lot of games are played. I would say more games are played in a German wedding than we have in America. And what I mean by game, so here's, you have the traditional cutting of the cake, just like we do in America as well, as I would say. And they're not sure about who's going to take the upper hand. You see, she's definitely taking it. Oh, Flo. But then you'll have your first dance, but you'll have, what I want to show you is the games. And there'll be games such as the groom has to get on his knees on a piece of wood, dressed up as a woman. So this is the guy who's getting married. And then the bride gets to make three wishes, and he has to say, yes, of course, honey, I will clean the bathroom every morning. Yes, of course, honey. And so he looks like Little Red Riding Hood. And so this guy's job, he's not a part of the family, he's just the party maker. They hire someone who is the party maker for the entire evening. And so he sits on there on his knees, gets made fun of, and we all have a good laugh. Yes, of course, honey, I'll do that. And such a party is truly a wonderful party. You'll see that, everyone, it's an open bar, you drink as much as you can, and it's a truly fun time. Somehow in this series of events, I ended up in something here I want to show you. I don't remember how, but I ended up here without my pants on. This was some game where you had to find an item from the crowd, and this was the final round. It came down to two of us, and you had to get a bra, but I was not fast enough. He got the bra before I did. His wife gave it to him. She knew it was coming. So, it's good fun and games. It's good fun and games. And then basically, you'll go and I did not know I was going to stop on that one. You'll go and people have been drinking the whole night, and you'll dance the night away with a live band. So, weddings in Germany are fun. They are a good time. From the Pultrabend to the actual wedding itself. Has anyone experienced a wedding in another country before? Anyone? Ever been to a wedding in another country?
Russia, Ukraine.
Was it different than in Belarus?
No.
No? I would guess, from personally, I would guess that Slavic weddings in general are very similar. It would be in Poland or Ukraine or Belarus, Russia, yeah? Well, in a bit, I want to hear... Sorry?
Practically the same.
Yeah? In a bit, I want to hear about Belarusian weddings. But first, we're going to talk about South African weddings. In South Africa, I had a very unique chance when living in a township in South Africa. We'll talk more about this in the week of South Africa to come. But I was living in a township, which is where the colonists basically put all the black people to live, the Afrikaners. Put the black people to live in the townships, and they could only live in the townships during the time of the apartheid, until 1994, for many decades. And in the townships today, it's still predominantly just blacks. And I was living there for 5 days in Daveyton Township in South Africa, outside of Johannesburg. South Africa is here. We zoom in, and we see Johannesburg, and it's basically a township in the suburbs of South Africa, and the neighbors were having a wedding, and in the middle of their wedding, they heard that I was visiting, a foreigner, just in the house next door, and they came over and said, hey, you've got to celebrate with us. It would be such an honor. So this is the groom, this is the bride, and this is some other family members of theirs, and you see the vibrant colors, okay? Yeah, they're no longer, you know, living in tribes, but they still have their tribal backgrounds. They still have their tribal traditions. You will hear that in their music shortly. And you see that she also has these rings around her neck. In the past, this would be to extend a woman's neck because it was seen that a long neck was beautiful. But today, it's just a matter of jewelry. And in the past, it was more of an actual extending of the neck. She does not wear this every day, no. This is just a traditional gown for the wedding. And you see the guy who's getting married, he's got his blue jeans on and a t-shirt, you know? He's chill. But I had no idea that day I was going to be going to a wedding. That's why I'm in shorts and a t-shirt. It was hot there. But in this Daveyton, township in South Africa, I had the lucky chance to witness this. And basically, they celebrated the house. The whole ceremony is at the house, in the backyard, and then they take to the streets. And so this would be like the close family. The maid of honor and the family of the bride and the best man. And the whole family then, including Babushka here, they all take to the street. And they carry their party to the street where they sing these tribal songs and dance in the street dressed up in such beautiful colors. I tell you, this is not what they wear every day. No, this is just for the wedding. A traditional gown from the tribal times. And they all take to the street. A beautiful dress. I mean, the beads and everything. And And they go right to the street and start dancing and partying right in the middle of the street. In the middle of the township. And everyone gets down. It started with the women, mostly the grandmothers. And then and there's no band, there's no hired party maker. They truly make the party themselves. And and the whistles and the dancing, the singing continued the entire night. As you see here, now it's starting to get late into sunset, and they started to chant in these ancient tribal songs through the streets. It was truly a beautiful time. Seriously, went on for hours. I tried myself to dance. I was totally offbeat, but and way taller than everyone else. Life experience.
What language do they speak there?
They speak a tribal language. In South Africa, just about each one of the people speaks 3, 4, or 5 different languages. English and Afrikaans are the most spoken languages between people, but in Daveyton there's about 2 different tribes that live there, and they have their own tribal language. Yo Zulu or something like that. I do not remember it. It's not a common language by any means. And they...
So you mean English by using some accents?
No, completely different. Completely different kind of tribal language. They do speak English with an accent, South African English, the blacks and the whites. Most of the whites, Dutch colonists, they speak Afrikaans, which is really close to Dutch. And I could understand, it was like, it sounded like German, like, oh, I could understand that. But then it was just enough different than German that I could not understand it. But it sounded a lot like German, Afrikaans. But they do not speak Afrikaans. They were forced to learn Afrikaans in the school. That was basically the language of the white people, Afrikaans. And the black people had their own tribal languages. But today, everything is mostly in English. News reports, everything is in English. But when they speak to each other and they sing, this is in their tribal languages. And that changes with each region, of course, different tribes. So, other unique wedding traditions. Those are the three countries in which I was in weddings. But I want to talk about some other unique traditions, such as in Japan, where the bride is supposed to cover her horns of jealousy, her horns of jealousy, towards her new mother-in-law, the mother of the man she's marrying. And so this is kind of the historical, traditional covering of the horns. We're like, you know, I don't like my mother-in-law. And this is the more modern-day covering of the horns. But you'll see Japanese women, it's called tsunokakushi, will wear this headdress for the wedding, as it is a covering of her horns of jealousy. And you see in Japan also, the marriage age is a little bit older than in the United States, with men being on average 31 and women being 29. In the Cajun and African cultures, does anyone know what Cajun is? Cajun is... Cajun would be a cultural region in southern United States around Louisiana. It has a lot of French and African influence into it. We saw Mardi Gras celebrated just in that state of Louisiana in last year's presentation on holidays. And this tradition of jumping over the broom, a broom, do you understand what a broom is? A sweeping broom. Mm-hmm. The bride and the groom will jump over the broom as a sign of getting married. And all of the single people will then dance with the broom. So if you're single, you have to dance with the broom. So the broom, the jump over the broom and the broom dance, the singles broom dance, it's expected to have originated in Ghana, West African country Ghana. And that explains a little bit why it's popular today in African cultures as well as the Louisiana Cajun culture, Cajun area of the United States, because it was heavily influenced by Africa and by French colonists there. And this is in America right here. I had no idea about this. It just shows you how vastly different regions of the United States are. The broom dance, originating in Ghana. And in Fiji, it is tradition for the groom to give the father of the bride a necklace with whale's teeth. So before he can marry this man's daughter, he must present a handmade necklace that he made himself with whale's teeth. And you see the traditional dress for a couple in Fiji getting married. And in Fiji, average age of marriage for men 28, for women 24. Are you familiar with where Fiji is? It's an island in the Pacific off of New Zealand, really close to where the international date line is, where the day changes from one day to the next. in the middle of the Pacific Ocean.
Moving on, Kenya. The Maasai warriors and the Maasai tribe in Kenya, they have one of the most bizarre traditions that I've ever seen. And this is the spitting of the bride. You spit on the bride to kind of bless her for her marriage. You see a little documentary on that here.
Spitting on the bride, Maasai Nation, Kenya. It's one of the most bizarre wedding rituals of the Maasai Nation in Kenya. At a wedding ceremony held by
the
Maasai people, the bride's head is shaved and the lamb fat or oil is applied to her head. The father of the bride blesses his daughter by spitting on her head and breasts.
I've never heard of anything like that in my life. What? In Kenya, in the Maasai Nation, that is their tradition. And it's probably something they've been doing for thousands of years. So, in Kenya, average age for a man 24, a woman 20, much younger, we see now. Further on, Scotland, the blackening of the bride. They throw whatever junk they can find, usually food stuff, so this looks like barbecue sauce. And, but not only on the bride, they do it for both. They take the bride-to-be and the groom-to-be, they put them in a trailer, and they haul them around the town, and everyone can come up and dump whatever gunk and foodstuffs, you know, whatever they have, they can dump on them. And it's called the blackening of the bride. It rolls off the tongue, blackening of the bride, but it's actually blacking of the bride and groom. And yeah, in Scotland, also in their 30s, 33 for a man, 30 for a woman. The idea behind this is that, well, if they can get through the blackening experience a couple weeks before the wedding, then they can handle anything together in their marriage. So that's kind of where the tradition comes from. And the blackening of the bride. And this is not in Africa, or this is in Scotland, a very well developed nation. And they still carry their bride and groom throughout the town and with whatever you got in the waste bin. So, moving on to Sweden. You may now all kiss the groom. So, in Sweden, they have a tradition where when the bride or the groom, when they stand up and leave the room, they will do this as planned. So the bride will stand up and leave the room. Then all of the single ladies who are at the wedding, they get to come up and kiss the groom while the bride is out of the room. Okay? It goes both ways. Then the groom will leave and all the single men get to come up and kiss the bride as well. And you may now all kiss the bride. And the average age of marriage in Sweden, 36 for a man, 33 for a woman. It's the oldest average age of first marriage in all of Europe, actually. Sweden, but this is kind of like your Svensky stol, yeah? A little bit for everyone. So everyone goes happy, goes home happy, I guess. So yeah, that is some interesting, unique traditions around the world. You see that in Belarus, the average age for a man 27, for a woman 25, a little bit younger than the ages in America, but certainly younger than that we saw in Europe, or Germany and Sweden. I appreciate the traditions that you shared with me, and I would like now to try our Kahoot quiz. Next question coming right at you. What is the most popular American honeymoon destination? Hawaii. All the time. Florida. Not quite. Alex Saint takes the lead! Whoa! It's a close one. Moksha's right behind Ina too. Next question. What country has the wedding tradition to cover the horns of jealousy? Well, everyone got that quick. Japan. Not China, not Korea, it's Japan. Alexei, close lead. He's got a faster connection.
Yes, some fairs.
Where are whale's teeth given as a gift prior to a wedding? Fiji is correct. Everyone got that one right. Very well done. Alexei is way ahead. Next question. In what country can all the single people kiss the bride? Sweden. Very well. Oh, not Scotland.
Scotland is trash.
This is trash. Malenka, Alexei, did he miss the question? Oh, he missed it. Heroes right behind, Mosh 2. Next, in what country is the blackening of the bride a popular wedding tradition? Scotland it is, all but one. No blackening in Sweden, they're still making out. No. Lolenka first, Ira right behind. Next question. Last question, where is the tradition of jumping over the broom thought to have originated? Ghana! Ooh, whoa, split board, look at that, 4-4-1. And the winner is? Lolenka, first place! Well done. For you, we have a chocolate from America sent here. A Reese's peanut butter, there's two inside, Reese's peanut butter cups, enjoy. So, do you like the Kahoot quiz?
Yes.
That's cool, huh? So I'm gonna do that after every lecture this semester, okay? So a little, you know, 10 question quiz, and it'll get more difficult, I think. And I'll have a little gift for the winner each lecture, okay?
Okay.
Cool, huh?
Yes.
Awesome. So, there we go. There was our scoreboard. Hero was close in second, really close. And Mosh right behind them. Alexei had it, missed it with the blackening. Or mixed, yeah, right before that, what was that? No, whatever. Nonetheless, thank you for coming to the first seminar of this semester. We will see you next week. I'm going to change the schedule a little bit, just in the subject, not in the time. We're going to do crime in the United States next week, okay? So we'll talk about gun laws and the crime and prison system in the U.S. And yeah, so thank you for coming, and we'll see you next week, all right? Happy belated Valentine's Day.